only usually come to see you twice a year. And tonight I'm here to request approval for the issuance of a $4 million TAN through Provident Bank. So I need that to go to bond council. And then I will be back probably in a month with the note to be signed.
TAN meaning tax anticipation note. Yes.
It's like a line of credit.
Any questions for Ellen?
Just, is this to tide the town through till the tax bills go out in June?
No, I should be fine. I always do it like right after we have town meeting.
Uh-huh.
And I haven't actually borrowed on a TAN in quite a few years.
Okay.
It's just in case something comes up and we need some cash.
Just in case.
Correct.
Okay.
Any other questions?
No.
A motion?
I'll make that motion.
Motion by Rick, seconded by Jim to authorize the
issuance
of a tax anticipation note if needed.
Yes.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Great, thank you. And
thank
I
you.
Should be, well, I don't know when they'll be ready, but it will be next month sometime.
Okay.
To sign the note.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We just like to give you a hard time, Ellen.
Christina is here tonight for the monthly financials.
I am.
How are you tonight?
Good, how are you?
Good. We're on now? Okay. Just to let everybody know, we are now on.
Just in time for me, huh?
Just
I
in
must
time
be good luck.
Good.
Absolutely.
Celebrity.
Just in time. Okay. So April financials. Everyone should have received those in your mailbox. They were actually ready early this month. I think they went out around May 10th, and they
yep.
are posted on the website also. So it is for the month of April. The target is 33.33%. In revenue, you'll see the difference in revenue from 2017 to 2018. The 2018 revenue is greater than 2017 by $146,271. The month's total income was $617,889. Of that, motor vehicles came in at $289,450. Interest on taxes at $54,048. Building permits at $26,314. Highway subsidy at $63,066. Departmental income at $31,447. Under parking lots, you'll note that the summer leases are at $50,937, and the daily lot revenue was $8,890. Interest on deposits at $23,754, and the real estate trust at $72,057. On the expense side of things, you'll notice that we're at 30.36%. spent or under budget by $727,688, or 2.97%. In April of 2017, we were under budget by $504,019. As you've noticed, this is a considerable difference compared to last month, which is a good thing. A lot of the quarterly, semi-annual, and yearly payments will continue to balance out as we get further into the year. Since we are coming up on the town's busy season, this gap in actual expenditures to budget will also close as we go through the summer. This month, I'll note any section or department that as a whole is over target. And I'll also point out all of the large departments where they stand. So the town manager is at 33.74%. Finance is at 34.3% when you include the open purchase orders. Legal is at 34.86%. Personnel administration is at 35.64%. The planning department is at 35.10%. General government buildings is at 34.66%. The police department is at 27.5%. Fire is at 29.9%. Emergency management is at 93.06%. Everyone always gets panicked at that one, but that's a $1,000 line, so you spend anything out of that and it is immediately at a very high percentage because it's such a small number. Other services, hydrants is at 51.97. We get those bills twice a year, so we've paid one bill so far. Public Works is at 31.4%, Parks and Recreation is at 31.8%. And on pages 17 and 18, you'll find the activity related to all of the individual warrant articles that were passed this year and in previous years. Fund 24, which is the Recreation Fund, has a balance of $209,614, which includes the beach sticker donations of $7,518. No scholarships have been awarded, but they will once they start registering for all the summer camps and stuff. Fund 25, the Cable Committee, has a balance of $421,736. The contract for the new studio has been awarded, so the balance in this fund will continue to drop as work begins. They were in here, I think it was last week. The company that was awarded the bid was in here starting to do like a site visit and work with the part-time employee on Channel 22 now. And that process is going to begin sooner than we thought, I believe. So that hopefully will be in place within a couple of months and up and running. Fund 26, the private detail, has a balance of $140,607. Fund 27, EMS, has a balance of $650,390. However, that we do still have the ambulance that's on order. I think Fred was saying it was being delivered this week and will be in service in June, but we haven't paid that purchase order. So there's $234,931 in an open purchase order. So that's not included in that balance. Wastewater system development charge fees collected in 2018 totaled $13,566. With a balance in this account of $210,315. And the board has approved a total of $97,376 worth of expenditures that are yet to be expended. So the adjusted balance would be $112,939. And that's my report.
Mary Louise, do you have any questions?
Yes, I do. Christy, okay. Good evening. Thank you for being here. You just talked about the wastewater system development charge, which we put in, Fred, if I recall correctly, in 2014. That's what I call the toilet tax. building taking place that has all new bathrooms. There's a fee, and Christy was kind enough, I think I asked her a couple of years ago,
yep,
to keep a running total on this page. Total fees collected to date, $393,592, and that's used by Public Works for small projects at no cost to the taxpayer. That's paid.
And the projects are all approved by the board,
right,
of selectmen.
Right, so I just wanted to point that out because that has been, I think, a very nice fund to have. Page 18 of 20,
yes.
1744, preliminary design downtown, that's Article 44. I'm still trying to get my head around this. As I understand, there were four quotes given to the town for the lighting, Consolidated Communications and First Light, which add up to the 11376 expended,
yep,
or open POs that you show here.
Mm-hmm.
And there was also a report from Unitil, and I can't remember the last one, Fred. Do you remember?
Another one was Comcast, I believe, and there was
Comcast
no charge, correct?
Is not going to,
yeah,
charge. But I think there was one other.
Unitil, I believe, was the one that was happened in 17.
That's
and
the 5,000 and change, but why?
No.
No?
The Unitil, I believe, was the 32,500, correct, Fred? That was
right.
Spent in 17.
Okay, right. So the 32,500 is not reflected in what?
It was off of the beginning balance. So instead, if you look at the, let's see, let me find that article in here real quick. So it was, the original article was for 300,000.
Correct.
The 32,500 was spent in 17, so the amount brought forward was $267,500. And then this year, we have expended $11,376. So the balance left in that account is $244,749, which I believe will lapse because that article lapsed on March 31st of this year, and there's no other expenditures. Fred, I'm looking at Fred for that, but I'm pretty
fair
sure.
Point,
that
fair point's part of that.
Fair
right?
Point is the other one, right?
So is Bayring.
Bayring.
But they didn't give us anything in before March 31st that I'm aware of, unless Fred has others.
They've.
No, you've got them all, including all the telephone.
Correct.
Yeah.
Okay.
But Why is it showing then an open PO, which I assume is consolidated in First Light?
Yes, that open PO has, since this report has been generated, has been liquidated. So there's no open purchase orders left.
Okay, so now on the available column, it's not really available because it lapsed on March 31st, but the balance that would have been available
is $256,125. That's the amount that will that will go back to the unassigned fund balance at the end of the year.
Great. I was just getting myself all confused on that, so I appreciate the clarification. And let's see, I think I had one more sitting here. Oh, the cable committee. We're going to be talking about this later on. So I guess I'm not going to address it now, Mr. Chairman. What do you think? We have the information right here, so we can discuss this while we're talking about the cable stuff. Thank you, Christy.
I have a question on the cable fund.
Yes.
So as of, we're seeing the balance as of April 30th.
April 30th, yes.
The 400, is it 400?
421, I think I said.
421,736.
Yeah.
So is there anything additional that has already been purchased?
Well, the contract for the station is $260,228.95.
Which has not been deducted from this
correct.
Balance.
Correct, yep. Okay. And I also projected out wages for the year and taking one-fourth of what has been spent so far and then multiplying it out. So my projected year-end balance at this point, if they get no other expenses, which is unlikely with the studio going, is $293,913.
Okay, after all the payouts and everything.
Correct, but I'm almost positive, haven't reviewed the contract again, but I believe that a piece of the contract for the new station didn't include all of the electrical work because we were going to hire a local electrician as opposed to using one of their electricians being shipped in from who knows where. And
yeah.
I believe the cable committee at that time had decided to do that. So I know that there'll be additional expenses in relationship to the contract for the new station that is open. So, but yeah, the station contract that was approved by the board is not included in the $421,735 that was the balance at the end of April.
Okay. I just wanted to ask that question while you were still up here. So, and one other thing I noticed, even though we've had a fairly not so nice April, that our parking revenue has gone up a little bit. So that's
it's about a $5,000 difference from April of 17 to April of 18.
So
it's a little money, but still every penny helps.
Yeah,
so
hopefully that will be a
I think
casinos had a bunch of shows, and that's what helps.
Yeah, we looked at that, actually, and the number of shows was comparable to last April. I don't know if it's just those few nice days and having the lights. Maybe that's the type of shows that have brought in more people. But, yeah, so and we had a couple of nice days, and I know that the police opened the lots on those nice days and stuff. So they've been bringing money up daily to us whenever the lots are open. They bring up all the money the next day and stuff. So we've been counting it and depositing it and putting some new controls in place in the parking lots. So
awesome.
I think you'll
see
a lot of improvements in that area.
Jim?
Yeah, thanks for the report. It's good. Yeah, revenue was up $146,271.
Yes.
What's that attributed to, you know? I mean,
usually it's motor vehicles. I didn't look at it that closely, but the majority of the time it ends up being the motor vehicles. Let's see if I can look through here real quick. Yeah, motor vehicles in April of 2017 was $1,064,771, and in April of 18 it was $1,185,000. So that right there kind of wipes out the whole 146 about, so.
And that's revenue that can fluctuate, right? I mean,
absolutely.
Yep. If people are buying cars and re-registering new cars, it's going to go up. If people aren't buying cars, and
yep. And then I also am noticing that we received a state water pollution control at $21,000 that we hadn't received in April of last year. It's probably just a timing thing though, because those are set, and so we have to receive them. I think we usually get it in May, so that'll probably be on the May report. Let's see if anything else up here is jumping out. Building permits, that's usually another good one for the difference. Building permits are up about 30,000 from April of this year compared to April of last year. So those are kind of the,
and that's another,
the larger of the ones, you know.
That's another revenue source that can fluctuate.
Yep.
Can go up or down.
Yeah.
Depending on how much building is taking place.
Yep.
And when we said that the parking revenue was up.
Yes.
Are the police manning that themselves, or do they have the employees? Do we have these?
We have some part-time employees.
Yeah. They can get it at a moment's notice?
Yeah.
Yes.
Generally speaking, yes.
Yeah.
So.
Ones they had before using.
Yeah.
Right.
And Victor's back, and a lot of the people, individuals who worked there last year are back. And I think they've hired a couple of new ones, not too many yet. But there's several returning employees who are retired, so they have availability and come in, you know, when they hear the weather's going to be nice. I think Lieutenant Gidley is the one who's leading the charge down at the police department for Chief Sawyer. He's one that we've been working closely with in finance to try and put things in the cash part in, did new practices so that it will be more acceptable to the auditors.
Okay.
For what we have going on.
And with the new practices, do we keep a running daily tally?
Yes, we do. We've always kept a daily tally.
Okay.
But we literally are getting the daily tallies the next day, as opposed to sometimes there was lapses in when we would have the information available for you guys. And now we usually, except for on Saturday and Sunday, because my staff's not here. But on all the days that we're here, they bring up the bags the very next morning.
And when people look at the individual line items, there's some individual line items that are like at 100%, 95%.
Correct.
There's a reason for that, isn't there?
Yeah, most of them would be like software contracts,
yeah, uniform pay.
Leases and uniform pay. Yep, that's all paid out the first payroll in April. Some of the career incentives might also be at the 100% because those are payroll related. In the fire department, you know, a large percentage of it goes out in April, and then the rest of it will go out in November. They're just like either once or twice a year type of expenditures.
And you keep a good tally, a good...
I go through this line by line every month and just kind of look to see,
so
and if anything...
it's a red flag.
Yes, I go and run a report on that line item and kind of go back and see what's been expended from that particular line and see if anything got misscored to the wrong line, or reach out to the departments if anything looks to be out
Thank
of
you.
Power.
Bert?
Yes. Are you able to make any determination if the amount of money that's coming in from the cable contract, is it at the same rate it always does, or is there more or is there less?
From the franchise fees?
Yeah.
I did actually look at that when I was looking at some of the cable things, and it seems to be, the franchise seems to be very close to what they normally are. It was split different before, so some of it was going to cable and some was going to the general fund. Mm-hmm. But the amount that's come in has been fairly level. I noticed that in one quarter of one year we got like 82,000, and then the next time in that same quarter of the next year we got 90, but then the following quarter it flip-flopped. So I'm thinking maybe one had the fifth week in it or something, you know. So then like the next quarter was 82 in that year and 90 in the year that had the 82. So they seem to be, I only looked back at like one or two years, but when I did look back at those, they were fairly steady with what we were receiving all along from that. I haven't seen any drastic increases or decreases in that.
Thank you so much for your report.
Yep.
That's all I got. Thank you.
That's all you got. Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next one, we have Norm Silverduck talking about the cable TV fund.
You need a butler, Christy.
Christy.
Whoops.
Good evening. This is our first opportunity to talk directly to the board with the prospect of interaction other than through public comments representing the rational taxpayers of Hampton. And with me is Jerry Zanoy, who is also a member of Rational Taxpayers of Hampton. And originally I had sent you a letter Rusty requesting the appointment, and I had 7 topics on it, and subsequently with communication back and forth with Fred, we were limited to discuss 1 topic.
That's right.
And I understand those are the ground rules and we'll respect them. And we do hope that we'll be able to return to visit with you periodically over issues that are near and dear to our interest. I'd like to start by just reiterating what our mission is, and we're not attempting to be gadflies in this community, but we are, our goal is to provide the Hampton taxpayers with facts and recommendations relative to issues that affect the services they received in Hampton and the impact the services have on their taxes and the quality of life. Our organization is diverse, and it's made up of all the political parties, Republicans, Democrats, and Independents. And we're all very passionate about our love for Hampton. And Jerry, if you want to add something to that?
Oh, basically, you know, we are fact-driven. We analyze very carefully. We're not impulsive. And I'm not implying that you are, but we are deeply analytical, and we go over the facts very carefully. We're strong believers in the prudent use of public monies. I'm a prudent person, financially conservative, frugal, at home. I run my budget this way. I ran industry big budgets with this kind of line of thinking. Not one line item I wouldn't study when the budget, well, I had 18 cost centers. It was quite extensive. In this town, we got like 420 line items. It was a piece of cake for me to look at every one of them. So we look at things very, very closely, and we're value-driven. We want to make sure that value is being obtained for dollars being spent. And we push on one another, and we're not a big group necessarily, but we're dotted line. We have a lot of dotted lines to various people who have held offices here in town and so on.
So we're talking about cable TV.
Yes. Right. Yes. And
that's our mission, though.
Okay. Under our, what for us was the concept of transparency, the cable TV, and we really feel that it's important for the taxpayers and for the public to learn as much as what happens in this community at your meetings, etc. And so for us, it's a systematic approach of being transparent. The cable TV fund has been a continuing issue for us. And the Warren article, which started out in 2016 at 40%, was modified at the deliberative session to 100% with 82,000 coming in 2015, and then moving to 286, 372, 90 for the first quarter this year, and the fund balance reaching the point of now 421, as described earlier, but also having hit over 500,000 prior to the expenditures. You had a discussion and approved spending and of the fund on a proposal that was submitted by the Cable TV Committee, and both for the cable channel 22 and SAU 90. During the entire time of your discussions, which were 30 to 45 minutes, not once was the amount of money discussed as to how much you all approved. And we think that was either you had the information in your work materials that was sent to you prior, but from a taxpayer's point of view, trying to find out what was going to be spent, we couldn't find that out. We did some research and subsequently were able to find out that 260 was to be spent. We still don't know what SAU's plans are and what they intend on spending out of this cable TV fund. And we think that this has to be made more transparent for the public to understand. And we support the fact that there's upgrades needed. But with the amount of money coming in, this fund's going to continue to accumulate $350,000 plus after you take out their normal operating expenses. And in 10 years, it's going to be $3.5 million. Our biggest fear is the more money that comes into a fund, the more money is going to be spent on something because it's there to be spent. And we question, both on a long-term basis, how much money is really needed for the cable TV fund. So while the current needs are being done, and I presume these needs will satisfy for an extended period of time, we wouldn't want to see, now we have all this money, let's have a full-time coordinator, let's have an additional expenditure for this and something else for that. Watching the television, as I did earlier tonight, the video is very mediocre watching it on the cable at home. The sound is, you can hear it now, which is better. If you want to see a high-def version of what's happening here or a very accurate video, you go to the town's website, which has excellent video, but not everybody's doing that. And we generally follow all your meetings, so we'll watch what's happening, and we go back into the video, and we can see it very easily, we can hear it very easily. But I'm not sure how many people watch it, and I'm not, and it certainly is not very inviting when the standard definition is washed out, faded, you can't quite capture everything that you'd like to. We really believe that that you folks should take a very hard look at what the long-term needs are for the cable TV fund. And we support a reduction in this fund, either, and we're going to present a couple ideas on how that should be done. And I'm going to let Jerry present that. We want to make sure that the needs of the community are met. But if we're being overfunded, that was money that was originally being used to offset taxes, a portion of it, part of it to cover the expenses of this, of the operation of the cable TV. And somehow or other, it needs to return to that way of being, in our opinion. Go ahead.
It boils down to $90,000 a quarter coming in, $360,000 a year pouring into this fund. Almost $4 million over 10 years, so, and that's going to be a lot of money sitting there and a lot of temptation to spend it. A lot of temptation. Anyway, so what really should be done? And I don't know if I have the answers, but I had a couple of thoughts. Here's my first thought. Cut the fee to 2%. In other words, instead of, it used to be 1%, they were getting 25% of the fund, give them 50% of the fund. Cut it from 4% to 2%. Now you're going to say, well, hold on, my God, Comcast, it'll take 6 months, 8 months, a year. I've been hearing that since 2009. What I would do, I would put Comcast on alert. The fund money would come in. I would direct the finance director to take 2%, put it into the fund, cable fund, and take 2% and put it into the unassigned fund balance for future taxpayer relief. That's one way to do it. Second way to do it is to eliminate the fund entirely, fund it by the line item in your operating budgets. Do that with a warrant article as well. Everything's got to be transparent to the public. And what you do is you eliminate the fee to zero. You put your line item in place, depending on what the budget calls for, to run the stations here at SAU. And indicate to the public that the fee is being eliminated and that the line item expense is being carried in the operating budget. And also tell the public that should this budget be rejected, the unassigned fund balance will fund the station for that particular year, to whatever its needs are, whatever the percentage is we decide on or the amount of money is. I would do it two ways, and I'd explain very carefully to the public what we're doing. But right now, we're taking, you know, a lot of money from the public, $360,000 a year. It's going to be pouring into this fund. It's going to be a lot of money sitting there and a heck of a temptation to use. It's going to be a strong will not to use that money. There'll be, like Norm says, a lot of things coming up. We need this, we need that equipment, we need this equipment, we need that director, we need these expenses. The money's there, so it's a temptation. It's a devil there, so to speak. So that's what I would do. I would either cut the fee to 2%, and if Comcast didn't react, I'd put them on notice, then I'd direct the finance director to move the other 2% into the unassigned fund balance for future tax relief. Or I would eliminate the fee entirely, put Comcast on notice. In the meantime, if the fund doesn't get eliminated for a month or two, it all goes into the unassigned fund balance. And then we cut a warrant article that we put it into the operating budget, whatever the two stations need, that's SAU 90 and Channel 22. And if the budget fails, we have a fallback plan to give them the funds they needed for that particular year. That's what I would do, one of two things. Those are my thoughts that came into my mind today as we were kind of looking this over. And there's probably other resolutions as well. Those are our thoughts.
Any questions from the board? Mary Louise.
I don't remember the year that the fund was set up. It was originally set up to garner 25%
right
of the franchise fees,
right,
which appear on your Comcast statement every month.
Right.
Right now, I think it's around $3. That worked for however many years. And then at the end of 2015, the then board, understanding that the school channel had come on in addition to Channel 22, and that they would need some gear to work with, that board of selectmen unanimously voted to create an article asking the public to delegate 40% of the franchise fees to support both Channel 22 and Channel 13. Unanimous vote. When we got to the deliberative session in February of 2016, one selectman made an amendment in spite of the unanimous vote by the board in the prior November, asking to increase the franchise fee contribution to 100%. And it has stayed that way for the last, two or three years. I agree that the total of the franchise money, which comes to about $340,000, $60,000 a year, it's a pretty good amount. Right now, it is being used to enhance the problems that we have with the cable transmission, and there will probably be more expenses now with the new addition on the academy with some of their expenses. I suggested a year or so ago, but it didn't go anywhere, that we restore by means of warrant article the 40% that we had proposed in 2016. I think 40% of the cable franchise fee, if of the Comcast franchise fees, could be comfortably given over to operate Channel 22 and Channel 13. The fund will be tapped right now for both the town and school with the new enhancements, which looked pretty impressive when the gentleman came in and promoted them to the board. But my long range, and I'm not hanging my hat on negotiating anything with Comcast, but my long range comfort zone is for 40% of the annual franchise fees to be donated to the cable functions. And then in the future, if that's not needed, you don't need so much, then you can put another warrant article on and reduce the percentage. But I think the 40% was sensible, and I would be happy with that in the future.
Jeannie? I'm glad that we're actually having the work done finally on Channel 22, because I think everyone wants to see that happen. But I think we need to maybe get to a point where we decide what needs to get done here and over at the school.
Yeah.
Figure out a timeline on that.
Yeah.
And I would be definitely in agreement that $360,000 a year going into this fund is way too much money.
Yeah. Right.
So at 40%, you'd cut it down. If Christy says over the past two or three years, it would go from 90,000 a quarter down to 36. So, I mean, that's still a good amount going toward it. So times four.
I see, yeah.
I mean, whatever that is. But I think we need to, like, let a little more time, whether or not the 19 warrant time would be the proper time for that. And I think we have to get more of an idea from both cable channels what their goals are.
I think I understood what Jim did. And, you know, what he's saying is, look, that cable fund was set up. That franchise fee was set up for... am I interrupting?
No, Jim, we're trying to figure...
No, I just said, can we finish the board's questions?
Yeah, well, I was going to respond to Mary Louise's, but and then, well, whatever. When you guys are through, I can make a comment.
I'm good. That's all I wanted to say.
Jim. Okay. First of all, I got to agree 100%, and it's our fault that when we did the contract for the studio, we didn't mention the money. I did a lot of checking today, and that was a total oversight, and that was totally wrong on our part.
Some of us looked at it twice, Jim.
Yeah,
we must have missed.
I totally agree that was wrong. That we didn't do that. No. That we had seen the figures and we didn't talk about it at the meeting. Okay. Absolutely, 100%. Yeah. Totally agree with that. On the cable, the franchise fee. The definition of the franchise fee is to provide money for PEG, right?
Right.
Public education and government channel.
Right.
I see my point on that is I see no reason why a certain portion of the population paying it, when 100% of the population is not paying it, it should go to tax relief. I do agree that if there's too much money going into it, we have to renegotiate, we have to cut it down.
Justin,
yeah. We have to cut it down to what it's necessary to fund the program. And I think on that aspect, I think we in the cable committee have been transparent on that, saying that they're gonna get the updates done first.
Yeah.
They're gonna come up with a budget on what it would cost them to run, what they figure a budget to cost to run the program.
Yeah.
The school is coming up with a budget on what's gonna cost them and what their upgrade, and I think at that time, I agree 100% that what we're getting now is probably too much money and it should be cut, but I still strongly believe that none of it should go to tax relief unless there's 100% of the people in the town paying it. So if I'm a cable subscriber, I don't see why I should pay an extra fee to reduce your taxes if you're not a cable subscriber. So that's, I think that's a logical question there. And I do agree on the part that we did not, and I don't think we were trying to hide it from it. I know we were not trying to hide it from anybody. We didn't mention it that night. That was wrong.
Right, well, accepting that as an oversight, and we've got that clarified there. I'm just curious that we have people who are subscribers to cable TV who don't own homes, who don't have property here, or renters who still can have be paying a portion of that. And we also have no competition. There's no other than contest.
The renter, though, is sort of paying taxes in his rent because the landlord is paying taxes, so there's taxes being paid on the property. So that's kind of an invalid argument to my way of thinking. That a renter is not, they're subscribing and they're not paying taxes. They're paying taxes in their rent, which goes to the landlord who pays taxes on his property. So that's my feeling on that. That's all I have.
Rick?
Well, I don't pay it anymore, so I'm glad. I switched to having an antenna. I like it much better.
Direct.
The picture's much clearer, and I like the channels better, too.
DirecTV. Right?
I do miss Channel 22, but I do, like Norm said, look at it on cable, and I'm so aloof to it, I didn't even realize it is clearer, but you're right, it is clearer.
Yeah.
You know, I don't need it that clear. I see it live right here. So it doesn't really matter. But I am in favor of it being readjusted in some way. And I'm in favor of the public deciding how it should be done.
And I agree with Jim. I think, you know, once we find out what it's going to cost us to run this, and it is new, we had much upgrade. Nothing had been done here since the system had been put in.
Right.
And so we really had to have that.
And I don't care. That's an upgrade we're in favor of.
But once that is done, we've talked to both this cable committee and the school and said, you gotta give us some insight into what it's gonna charge you, what you think it's gonna cost for each year. And that, once we have that figure, I got no problem in reducing the amount of the fee that is charged to the Comcast people. I don't, however, think that because we have the fee here, that it should go to the reduction of taxes. Because myself, I've never had Comcast. So why is that fair for you that pay Comcast, that I get a reduction in my taxes because you pay a certain fee? I think that if we don't need that much, then we should adjust that fee. And now's the time to do that while we are working with the cable, the Comcast, and negotiating their contract. So hopefully we're gonna have all this information and we're working on that. So, but that's the way I see it. I don't see it going back into the general fund.
I agree.
I think that we should get what we think we're gonna need.
Right.
As a fee, and then move forward.
And the rest of it shouldn't be there.
That's right.
I think that's the ideal approach is, what do you really need to spend to operate?
That's right, and we've asked for that.
Yeah.
And it's gonna be different. You know, I get, probably the biggest thing I get phone calls on is Channel 22. People calling about the problems they have with Channel 22. I would say by far, that's the most phone calls I get. And people watch, more people than you ever thought of watch Channel 22. Which I am very surprised at. But they do. And so they wanna have a good, clear, sharp, crisp, volume picture. And that's what we're trying to do first. Once we get that, then we can figure out what it's gonna cost us and we can adjust that fee.
Well, I think we're all in agreement on the point of fairness, of equity for the people that are paying the fee, and what's best for the town and what's best for those who are paying. We just made an assumption that the majority of the subscribers just would happen to be taxpayers of Hampton. So that was our assumption.
No, and I just think that they, you know, there's a lot out there that don't have cable.
Yeah.
It's a peg channel. We should keep it pure to its mission, is to fund, you know, the public education government channel.
And I think the school's doing a great job on theirs, and I think we've done a fairly decent job on ours, keeping it done.
And we hope when our folks come in and talk about what they need, SA United comes in and talk about what they need, that we're really prudent. Listen to them carefully and be very prudent about public monies, because
I think we've been trying to do that. Okay. I totally agree. There was an oversight there that we had the information and we just didn't telegraph it. But the information was out there. You obviously found it. So,
well, I want to thank you for.
I want to mention that we can do this periodically. There are many topics we can really engage in and be productive with respect to one another. And a sewer ordinance upgrade, the status on the sewer plant upgrade, which I don't know where we are on that. North Beach Wall, we've studied that now. We've had the engineering drawing. We know a lot. We have a lot of questions on that.
But if those topics come up and you guys feel strongly about a certain topic you want to come in and talk about, by all means, put in a request and we can do that.
It'd be nice to have a contractor here too, if in fact the questions are related to a contract.
Well, I mean, that's kind of what the Board of Selectmen's job is.
Yeah. We're not trying to be a...
We're not trying to manage the town.
Well, and that's what I say, you know, we talk about transparency. I've looked to find out about your organization. And it's hard to find information about it. Real hard. Yeah. It's real hard to find out where the minutes are, where the meetings are held, you know?
And who's in it.
You'll
have to get on the agenda.
Well, and maybe we'll have to do that, you know, because, you know, you say that Mr. Zanoy is speaking as a member, but how do we know who the members are? The only two people listed are you and Mr. Pierce in Concord.
No, I signed that agreement, too.
Well, but that was in before 2015. They revamped it in 2015, so now it's just Mr.
Norm
and
I thought it would.
Mr. Pierce. Those are the only two people that are listed on that.
Yeah, I was.
So, we want to talk about transparency.
No, I agree, but we're not a public, we've had the discussion, and we'll have it again about opening our kimono for more transparency within our organization.
I'm for all about it being a public comment.
Yeah, just as one final, because you are focusing on revenue, which is an excellent focus, you need to give some consideration to what's been happening with impact fees.
We've talked about impact fees, and we do have a position on that.
Thank you.
Very good. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot.
Town manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, I guess I'll go back to the town clerk's earlier remarks. Please register your dog. We'd like you to do that as soon as possible, because the state law automatically increases the registration fee as time goes along. We don't want anyone to pay more than the minimum for a dog registration. Household Hazardous Waste Day is September 23rd. It runs from 8 a.m. to 12 noon. It will be at the Public Works facility on Hoddard's Way. The last chance to change your political party registration is Monday, June 4th, for the September primary election. If you are interested in summer seasonal work, please contact the Public Works Department. We have 13 weeks worth of work for quite a number of people. It's very important. And just remember that this coming week, we're going to have Veterans Day and, Memorial Day, and we're going to have an activity at the beach at 8 o'clock and another activity uptown for a parade at 11, or thereabouts, depending on when the previous parade gets over with. And that's it, Mr. Chairman.
Mary Louise?
I have questions for the manager. Do you want me to do that now or wait for old business?
Is it?
I have several.
Okay. Well, we'll see what they have to do with his report or?
He just made his report.
Well, then
it's 1, 2, 3, 4.
Well, okay. Then I'll wait until whole business.
Regina?
I guess I'll wait till whole business.
Please don't put us in November when we're only in May. Veterans Day is November, right?
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I don't want to lose the whole summer, please.
We get to celebrate it twice.
Okay.
Rick?
No, thank you for your report.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, old business. Mary Louise?
The UFB, Fred, because that's become popular and people are looking to dip their fingers in it. What base of the undesignated fund balance do we need to keep in place in order to shore up our bonding ability?
At the minimum, it's 5% is a recommended sum for the by the Department of Revenue Administration for the state of New Hampshire, and the maximum is 17%. Right now, we're about 6.5%. Sort of put it in terms I think people can understand, we collect taxes twice a year, and we have to run a $30 million corporation during the course of the year. Those taxes have a first call by the school departments and by the Hampton Beach precinct, and by the county, which means that we spend almost one half of our money that's collected during the course of the year through the tax collector's office to run those organizations. They have first call. We do not collect all of our taxes. We run somewhere between $2 million and $2.5 million in unpaid taxes at any one point in time. So that's the way the board has this structured. That's the minimum we have to keep in the undesignated fund balance or the unassigned fund balance, depending on how you want to term it. If we were to commit what was mentioned here tonight, we'll be running exclusively on tax anticipation notes. There won't be any question in my mind about that. There'll be no cash available because we'll strip the account. Right now, we're running somewhere around $5 to $6 million in that account, give or take, depending on what the audit comes up with. It could be as high as $7 million.
It was $6.6 million last time.
It's kind of fluctuating around, and there are things that are going to be adjusted by the auditors on that. That's what funds the town. That's what keeps us running in between tax collections.
Right.
The majority of the money we collect in taxes. Let's talk about this time of the year, for instance. Right now, we're running on the school collections, which were made in December. We also have to pay the schools out of that.
Yeah.
So we're not borrowing any money because we have this surplus that we sit on, and we use that to fund things. Perhaps a good example would be the replacement of the sewer line on Lafayette Road. We started that without any bonding at all. And the only reason we were able to start it and not have to wait for bonding is because we have a surplus.
Yeah.
That surplus cash is being used for that. If we had to wait for money to be appropriated and we had to wait for the collection of those dollars, we wouldn't be starting it until this spring. That would be a year and a half after we decided that we needed to have it done, because we would have no money. We just have nothing to expend.
Well, I can remember your comments about the situation that you found when you took over as manager in 2007.
It's interesting.
And that is a cautionary tale. I get very nervous when too many fingers are going into that undesignated fund balance.
We could get hurt severely if the fund balance were dropped to too low a margin.
Mm-hmm. Next. Oh, the REDC. I don't know where I put the paperwork. It looks like we're eligible.
Wait a minute.
Oh. Well, I had it when I came in. I don't know what I did with it. But what are we going to be using that? Here it is. New project submission sheet. And it, you, I guess we missed the deadline, but they're still letting us apply. What is that going to be?
That's to take care of the school funding for safety,
which is Winneconnet Road sidewalk.
Winneconnet Road, well, the street. When they asked us to submit something,
yeah,
we sat down and thought about what we could submit that would have a good impact on the citizens of the town and the safety of the people. And we thought immediately about the school department's previous plea to take care of restructuring Winneconnet Road. So we submitted an appropriation for $2,500,000,
yes,
that would take care of Winneconnet Road. Just it's more than the road. It's more than the sidewalk. It's also the sewers and all of the drains.
Okay.
The island portion out here, everything all the way down to Mill Road.
Mm-hmm.
Getting all of that done, get the parking properly aligned, mm-hmm, take care of all the sidewalks. Do that all in one shot with state funds if we can get them.
Mm-hmm, right. I appreciated seeing that. And, of course, theoretically a safer route to school with the youngsters walking, hopefully, on the sidewalk.
Well, we keep our fingers crossed every day. I often stand in the front window of the second floor of the town hall watching the parade of children going into the school across the street, the center school. And we have two police officers out there during school crossings in the morning, along with two crossing guards, and we frequently have the police running radar out in front here all day long.
Terrible.
So we try to keep the traffic to a minimum. We try to keep the children safe and the adults, yeah, bringing them to school safe, but it's a task, and the road's not structured to do that very well.
Well, what I like to point out is that Center School, which is the focus of much of this, has its own semi-circular driveway, mm-hmm, where people and children can descend from the school buses safely without extra traffic. I had four kids and they got picked up in front of the house in the school bus and went to school. I never drove the kids to school, so I'm a little, that's a little problem.
Can I just comment on that, the safety of school?
Mm-hmm.
We do provide a lot.
But
kids from the west side take their lives in their own hands, and my grandkids walk when they cross the major intersection uptown. And we should be encouraging kids to walk for health reasons, for all sorts of reasons. And I know my granddaughter, who's 11 years old, walks to school frequently, and it scares the heck out of me because that intersection is horrendous. And we should be encouraging walking, not discouraging it.
And we should be doing something about these intersections.
Yeah.
Well, people have taken school buses for years and with not too much damage. The industrial surcharge fee, you have a feeling, Fred, for when we might get some overview, whether it's from Wright Pierce or somebody, exactly how we do it. I'm not saying we need to do it this minute, but can we have an overview of what it entails?
They're working an omnibus program for you, and it involves more than just that.
Okay.
And I've encouraged them to speed it up, because I want the whole program presented to the board.
Because you said she's being a pain in the neck.
No, it's not being a pain in the neck. I'm being a pain in the neck on them to get it done.
Good.
And they're working as hard as they can to get it done, but they've got too much on their plate at the moment. So they're doing this as they can, and it's taking quite a while. And I know that they're uneasy about that, but they are trying very hard to get that done. We need to have this done. There are a lot of reasons we need to have it done, mm-hmm. and they're working diligently on it. Hopefully, we're going to have it quite soon.
I just want you to know that I'm not going to forget it.
Oh, neither am I.
You probably figured that out. And the last thing, would you explain, please, to the public what you explained to me before the meeting started? Because I have had questions from the public when we're going to do the temporary sewer line while we're getting ready to do the actual construction. People are saying, why are we renting? Can't we just buy that pipe and then use it? So, if you would.
The pipe is designed to lay on top of the ground, not to be buried in it.
This type of pipe.
And it's a single wall, continuous pipe. It is welded together. There are no joints for the entire length of it. Mm-hmm. It's not the type of pipe that we would normally use. It's for a very special occasion. In this particular case, it's a temporary and emergency pipe that needs to be taken out in the wintertime because it will not. Yep. It cannot be frozen, otherwise it will break.
I appreciate that, because people, everyone, they say a pipe is a pipe.
Not really.
Well, but that's why.
That's what they said when they put the duck, the lion, and the marsh.
Yeah, well, that's true.
Yeah. So I appreciate that.
Iron doesn't
you.
Like salt water.
No.
Okay. I just want to actually, one thing I want to add to what you said about the schools. I think I know a lot of moms that they drive the schools. They drive their kids to school every day. And the reason for that is some of these, because of the way the school buses have to, and I understand why, for safety and all that, but they stop so frequently that some of these kids, it's taken them like 30, 40 minutes to get to school when they just live, you know, down around the corner or whatever it is. So I 100% agree with Jim. I think that if this is a good, would be a good way. I mean, not only do we have pretty much one account, it takes you to any school in Hampton. You know, mm-hmm. we have our fire station there, we have a police station there. I mean, I think this would be a really, really good project. And I'm glad that REDC is also being supportive of it for state funding for us.
Yeah, that's good.
And I do think that we definitely need to encourage, I mean, we live in a town where kids can ride their bikes and walk to school, so if we can make it safe for them road-wise to do that.
It's the whole idea.
Then I think it would be a really great idea. And then as far as the old business that I had, since our meeting last week, I've done a little side work with a specific resident that's trying to build something, and it's 595 Ocean Boulevard. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a statement to the board, yeah. and then I'm going to follow that by a motion, if that's okay with you. The residents of North Beach area, whom I spoke with, seem to be in agreement that Mr. Flynn's project at 595 Ocean is long overdue. As a selectman for the local taxpayer, I am in agreement. Currently, the land owned by Conservation Commission is vacant, neglected, and non-taxable. The law, as discussed last week, does not allow the town to sell or lease land owned by Conservation. Clearly, the selectmen have no authority here. Last week, the board was concerned with additional fill added to the wetlands. If Mr. Flynn is allowed use of the conservation-owned parcel for entrance to his on-site parking, which would be underneath the building he would put up, he will donate the unbuildable portion of 597 Ocean, directly north of the property, to the Conservation Commission, removing the existing fill and simply transferring the existing fill to 595 Ocean as needed. It's a larger space at 597, so the fill he removes, he wouldn't need as much of it to put in that one strip of land that is conservation that he just wants to drive on to get into his parking. Mr. Flynn, also, since last week, Mr. Flynn has set up a meeting with the town's building inspector, Kevin Schultz, which will take place next Wednesday, I believe. He has also hired and contracted with Ambit Engineering of Portsmouth for the site work and to file all local and state permits as a necessary deemed by the town and the Conservation Commission. Mr. Flynn's project will be an asset to both the residents of North Beach and the community as a whole. So I would move to make the motion that the Board of Selectmen allow Mr. Flynn to use conservation-owned land to access his 595 on-site parking. Mr. Flynn, in return for this use, will donate the unbuildable portion of the land, per the building inspector, of 597 Ocean Boulevard to Hampton Conservation Commission, a parcel that is larger than the existing parcel Mr. Flynn wishes to have access to. Existing fill will be transferred or removed, and he'll get new fill, however you want to look at it, from 597 to be used as needed to 595 Ocean Boulevard. That's the motion.
Okay. I will actually second that for discussion. So we have discussion.
I don't know why we're getting involved in this.
Why do we, my discussion is, do we even have the authority to do that, Mr.
Yeah,
Manager?
I don't think so.
I agree.
Without an act of the legislature, you don't, legally. That doesn't stop the town from asking the legislature for an act. But I think you're going to have to get the act from the legislature in order to be. What I don't want to do is I don't want to do something that we've been told is in violation of the statute.
Yeah.
Allow something to happen and then have somebody come in and say, no, no, you shouldn't do that. Tear it all out.
Yeah.
I don't want that to happen.
In the past, people donate this land. There's condominiums coming down all in this area.
Yeah.
You know, Little Jackstone's halfway across the marsh. You know, and if they want to donate it, they donate it. I don't see why we're getting involved in it. This is something that I've
because this is something that since we've made our decision last week, I've had a lot of people that are unhappy about the decision that we made.
Well, you know, the thing is, we didn't have any part of it. We didn't do anything. Whatever happened there this week happened without anything to do with the Board of Selectmen, with whatever Kevin Schultz did, whatever. It's just, this is something I've never seen the board get involved in something like this, and I'm not for it.
Well, I made my motion because that's the way I feel, so it can go unheard, but I get to say how I feel, so.
Well, I think, you know, and that's why I brought it up for discussion, because I want to hear the discussion on this. I want to hear what people have to say. Mary Louise, you?
I'm not going to counter conservation's authority.
I agree with the I'm not going to counter conservation.
And no one's against it, but you know what? If, you know, I'm not against Mr. Flynn's rights. But, you know, if we're going to start this conversation, then I would like to make a motion about what happened to Norm Beaulieu down at the Kentville this week. You know, so we could do this every time that there's a issue that comes up. You know, there was a very controversial issue that his condo project was voted down when he has buildings that are higher on each side of them. And I understand how it works, it's the process, but a lot of people don't think that's fair. A lot of people aren't happy with a lot of what's going on, and I don't see how we can get involved with it. These different boards, whether it's the Conservation Commission, whether it's the Planning Board, whether it's the Zoning Board.
To call that land conservation land, I'll tell you right now, is comical. If you go down and look at it, it's comical.
Well,
it is sitting there untaxable when it could actually be used for something that will benefit the community.
Well, that's, like Mr. Walsh says, that's what the law is, and we can't just be changing it ourselves.
You know, and
we did before.
The law has changed a lot since.
It wasn't in the Conservation Commission before.
It wasn't in conservation, and the law has changed a lot.
That
since,
whole area is going to flood.
Since that area, since that was changed, you know, Mr. Flynn brought up the fact that some of that area on both sides of it was filled. Some of that was filled in the 1950s. Some of it was filled in the early 80s. You're talking 30 years ago where our laws have changed, and that's the problem Mr. Flynn has right now.
It was,
you know,
different.
It was
I'm the one that made the motion to do it before. It wasn't owned by the Conservation Commission then, when we rented it to Lupo's.
So
it became part of the Conservation Commission when it was taken for lack of taxes, I believe.
I believe that was.
That whole area is going to flood.
Nah, that's beside the point, and that's not necessarily true either. And we could go on and on and on. We could say by people putting condominiums are making it worse. But, you know, that we can't get involved in everything.
Right.
I just think the proper way to do this is to we actually have to go to the legislature and ask them. I think that's
as a remedy.
there is a remedy, and I think that's the proper way to do that. So, yeah, I feel bad for Mr. Flynn. He has a piece of property there, but our hands are basically tied. We can't do it unless we get the authority from the legislature with a special exemption. And that's the sad case of what it is. So we have a motion. All those in favor of Regina's motion? All those opposed? 4-1. So.
Oh, thanks for hearing me.
Old business?
Old business.
Yeah, I'd just like to bring up a couple of things under old business. First of all, I'd just like to ask, make sure, the fire department came in and we talked about the extra outfits and stuff and setting up a fund. That's still being worked on.
Yes, it is.
That's moving forward.
It is.
Okay, because I just want to make sure that we stay up on that. The other thing I want to make, just a comment on the marsh pipes, which would come under old business. You know, we had people in here talking about physical responsibility and all that, and using, you know, a lot of people saying using the undesignated fund for this project, which would be fiscally irresponsible if we did that. I think the people are speaking wrong. I mean, right now, as you said, we don't go to the tax anticipation notes. We don't have to borrow any money, true?
True.
Because we have an undesignated fund.
Right.
We also get, in the last few years, very good reports from the auditors, I believe, that we're just about 100% in compliance with everything. And one thing, because we're keeping that 8%. So, I mean, some of the comments that were made tonight are physically irresponsible, not being prudent in watching our money. And I think that the board has been prudent in that aspect, and I think we should stay prudent. And I think it's because the town manager has pushed us to make sure that undesignated fund stays at the appropriate level, which I think is very important. And then there was another comment made that we don't need to have the pipe in the winter. Well, we do, right, because of excessive high tides or storms.
The storms are what hurt us this year in the wintertime.
And we needed both pipes.
We were running 10 million gallons of material per day into the treatment plant, up to that sum. It depends upon how you look at the day.
Yeah.
But, you know, on the average, 5 million gallons over three days is a lot more than the plant's supposed to take.
Yeah.
So that water is coming in from the ocean. And we have to treat it. And we did. Now, we didn't do anything wrong. We treated every bit of it, and we discharged it, and everything was discharged in accordance with the rules. But we can't do that forever.
Right. And I think everybody has their own opinion, which is fine. But we pay engineers to make studies. We pay engineers to give us information. And we should listen to the engineers when they give us the information. So I think I know we've been physically responsible. Also, there was a mention, I think, in some notes and stuff about excessive taxes and stuff like that. Everybody's tax bothers them. But, you know, in the last 10 years, our budgets have only gone up 5%. In the last 5 years, the budgets have gone up 4%. In the last 3 years, they've gone up 0.91%. And the tax rate has gone down. Mm-hmm. So it's valuations. People have to face that.
Absolutely.
So I believe we're being fiscally responsible.
Mm-hmm. Since Jim brought up the marsh pipes, I wanted to say I agree. I know I wasn't here. I wasn't active in the town, I guess you call it, when Mr. Welch came on board. But he told me of his experience with the unassigned fund balance when he first got here.
Yeah.
And having that security, whatever it is, I want to say it's what we say between 5 and 6 million, somewhere around there.
Yeah, it's about as high as 8.5 million. It's down somewhere between 5, 6, 7 million dollars, somewhere in the. We don't have the audit finished yet, so we don't know exactly what it is.
Right, but simply draining that for a yes, I would say that these pipes are definitely an emergency, is not responsible. You know, that's like booking a month vacation and, you know, not making sure you have anything in case something happens. And that's what the town does. And I think that luckily with the support of our legislators and our state senator and former state senator, we're going to have a bill heard. Or it's already partially been heard, or the Senate's hearing it next week.
No, the Senate will be hearing it, I believe, on Wednesday. They'll be voting on it on Wednesday. There's no hearing because of the lateness of the filing. It appears that this week on Wednesday, the Senate will be hearing this bill on the actual debate, and they'll be voting on it. And at that point, if they pass it, it will go over to the House of Representatives for their requirements, and if they pass it, it'll go directly to the governor for signature.
And I would also like to add that if anyone's ever looking for expenses to decrease, that will never happen. What we have to find is additional revenue.
Somebody give me a printing press, I'll be happy to take care of everybody's problems.
Did you have anything?
I agree with one of the things that Mr. Zanoy said, and that I think we made a mistake not to have looked further into this when it happened before. Or did we? Did we do a study with an engineering study then?
On
like what we did with when they made the determination that the pipe was brittle.
You're talking about the marsh pipes.
Yes, the first time it happened.
Okay. No, we did not hire an engineering firm to go in and do an extensive study as we did this time.
Yeah, so it appears to me that's where the big mistake was made here.
Could
I
be.
Thought about it and thought about it, yep. And to me, that's the way it looks.
It could be, and at that time, it was a lot of money to do it, mm-hmm. And we coughed it up and did it this time because we mm-hmm. felt it had to be done, and we found out a lot of information about those pipes that we did not know before. We should have done it before, but hindsight's perfect.
Yeah,
it is in every case.
And I understand that, but that was one I was interested to see that was his first point, and I've been thinking about it, and I agree with that.
I think the reason it was not done before, when the second breach occurred, you could literally take the pipe and tear it apart with your first finger and thumb. Mm-hmm. You couldn't do that with a sledgehammer on the first break. Mm-hmm. So there was something radically wrong with the pipe that's in there. And this pipe was not covered with plastic, apparently, completely covered with plastic. So that meant it was intermixing with salt water and brackish water all the time. So there was severe deterioration to it. I had to read it twice. But what I walked away with from the engineering report was that the best part of the pipe is the concrete liner. And I looked at the picture of the liner, and it looked like a piece of Swiss cheese with all the holes in it. And if that's the best part, then we were in serious trouble, but we did not know it at the time.
Mm-hmm. And I'd like to also say, you know, about the walking to school and that. And I had a reason to ask this question recently, mainly because, you know, knowing how much money we spend on school buses and that. But where I went to school, that you have to walk to school. I mean, your parents can drive you too, but I don't think it was most parents didn't drive their kids to school years ago.
Right.
And if it's you only got to ride the school bus if you were more than 2 miles away from mm-hmm. the school.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I hated walking to school.
But that's the school. That's the school board.
And it was
and
hot.
That's the school board that has yeah. to discuss that. That's not up to us.
And I even had a skin cancer worked on today at the dermatologist, and I was thinking, I think that happened when I was walking to school.
Probably.
And I used to think, I'll never do this to my kids, but I don't have any kids. But I did, I look back upon it also. Some of the funnest times I had was when I was walking to school or taking my bike. You know, it was always different. My mother made me walk to school when it was raining. And then the one year I went to school here in Hampton, I did live 2 miles away, and I loved riding the school bus from right where my home is today. And in those days, the same kids. You were probably really a baby then, Rusty, because I don't
Sorry.
Think you were on the bus. But the same kids for high school were on there with the first graders
yep.
from down at the beach.
Yeah.
And I still had to walk home when I got detention. My mother wasn't about to give me a ride home. And I can remember walking all that way through the snow back to 529 Ocean Boulevard. But so it is interesting, and I think the kids should be provided with a way to walk safely to school. And I wonder if some of the expenses for the pipe could come from the unassigned fund balance. I mean, there might be some things that could be done, maybe start a little sooner or whatever. You know, maybe, I don't know, I'm just throwing that out there.
We've looked at it, and we may be able to apply some money. One of the things that we committed to do was to apply $1 million to decrease the tax rate this year from the unassigned fund balance. If we're going to commit the money to this pipe, then that won't happen, so the tax rate's going to go up. Don't want that to happen either. So we have to somehow, well, we've got to wait till we see the balance of the audit report. We need to know where that is in very specific terms. And then we will try to designate how much we can afford to take out of there and still we have enough money to reserve to for our operating capital for the schools in the town.
Yeah. But if there is any way that some of the partial expenses could come out of there at the beginning and maybe make it so that the rental of the overland pipes would be less or something like that. I mean, I think it's something that we could look at.
It's not up to me, it's up to you folks. We figure this, my best guess is between $1.5 million and $2 million for the temporary pipes. This is, building these new pipes is not a 2 or 3 month job. It's going to be postponed for part of the winter for the hard part, and then take up again in the spring. And in the spring, you're going to have to put those overland pipes in again.
That's the pipe that's the part that makes me most uncomfortable. So I think if we pay a lot of attention to that and really take a look at it and see if there are any other ways that things might be slightly different or more cost effective.
We have to study that closely. Yeah.
So that would be, if that's a possibility, just to keep our eyes on that. I am against groups coming in on a regular basis, like what happened here tonight. I don't mind. I think this was a good thing to do for this particular item. But there's a lot of groups out there, and they're going to all want to come. And
that's why I limited it to one topic.
And I think that's
and
wise.
That we're not going to have this coming in with 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 topics. If you've got any citizen that has a concern, a question, a comment, should have that ability. Whether you're a group or whether you're a single person.
Yeah. Well, then maybe a single person should come in. If they have a lot of other items, they can come to public comment just like they usually do.
I believe you're right there too.
Because next thing we know, we're getting pop shots at us. I'm just against it. And although
I agree with Rick that public comment's more the appropriate venue for that.
Absolutely, but he had such a list. Yeah. That I allowed him to have one topic.
Yeah. Yep. And the public comment is a good way, it's a good way to begin the conversation. Yep. If someone has public comment and that steers up the board to wanna have something, they can ask to come in. But at the end of the day, it's up to the chairman. It's up to the person that's chairman this year, that's you, Rusty. And it's up to somebody different next year.
Correct.
So they decide how the meeting's gonna go. And I don't think that we should just be doing this and establishing a relationship that this is going to continue. It's done on a case-by-case study.
It's up to the chairman to decide. And that's the way I left it. They want to come back, and I said, if you've got a specific case you want to bring, if we feel it's warrants enough, we'll have a discussion. But we're not going to have this rehash.
I think you handled it very well.
Thank you.
I'm going to mention it. Well, first I want to make a motion to reaffirm the motion that this Board of Selectmen made before for the Hampton Beach Area Commission to continue whatever they're going to do. It should go at least to Winneconnet Road, and then in the future, when they want to make those future plans, all the way to High Street. And I would... as far as I'm concerned, and pretty much what I heard from the people, people are looking to have roads, the roads and sidewalks. I think the drainage is important. And I'd say pretty much they said roads, sidewalk, and safety issues, which translates into crosswalks. But I would like the motion, I'd like to make a motion that it at least go to Winneconnet Road, which is the gateway for all of the people from Hampton. And I'd also like to say that the big part that really got the most emotion going was that 1 mile of being able to drive along and look at the ocean when you are driving along, looking at the ocean, coming from the south, you're going to Winneconnet Road. When you are riding along the ocean, looking at it, going south, you're coming from Winneconnet Road. I think it's been foolhardy, right? And I have been there every single time I've had the opportunity. I have voiced these opinions. And these opinions were seconded by 38 other people. I only heard one person comment the other way, and that was about the ocean walk. There was a favorable comment made about that. So I'd like to make a motion that the roads and sidewalks, drainage and safety issues, at least to Winneconnet Road,
second,
be considered. And that's that's reaffirming the board's decision to make that motion before.
I got another qualm too about there, just with things that have happened recently since we had the meeting on May 10th.
Yeah.
So now that, you know, I go down there, now that we actually had some weather, I've been down there, and all the neighbors that are always down there walking the wall, the same ones every morning, afternoon. Well, we had sent some pictures in because some of the steps were in really rough shape, which is probably from, you know, this past winter. That's fine. But they just have, like, instead of, I mean, I don't know how you fix a cement step. I would imagine you just put more cement on it, but I don't really know.
Usually works.
But now they just have, like, a rope, like a single rope that easily, like, people could, you know, walk under. And it's not, well, yeah, but it's like literally, I don't know if any of you had a chance, but there's, I guess, I've seen two of the openings, and I guess people are telling me there's three or four of them where the steps are in bad shape. They have them roped off. But what if people still use them and something happens?
That's not part of this study, though. I will tell you that. The wall isn't. But I will tell you also that I know from seeing the people that have complained, I've seen some of the letters, and I've heard both from Nancy Stiles and from someone else. I've seen the letters going back and forth to the Area Commission, that there is somebody working on that for the state.
Okay, because that's like really just scary.
I believe it's
some girl,
I want to say,
Meredith,
has been going back and forth, and that's probably why the ropes are up there right now. But they are looking at it, and they've told Nancy Stiles they're going to do something about it. At least I believe they have. But I've seen the correspondence going back and forth, and I will bring it up this week at the Hampton Area Commission. But I don't think that's part of this study.
I know it's not, but you know, we're talking about safety. Yeah. That's like a huge safety thing.
Yeah, it is.
Is this our, do we have the authority on this? I don't understand
what
we're
doing.
Well,
we did it before, and I'm saying we should
just
do it again.
I'm just asking what we're doing.
Right. The thing I can see is it's sort of like we sent the letter last week asking the state to do the crosswalks. Instead of demanding the states do the crosswalks.
We're taking a position here, and the decision hasn't been made.
Oh, okay.
We're taking the position that we would like to see them continue it on to Winneconnet Road.
Fine. And this position has been made before. It's also been unanimously by the Hampton Village District. And from what I read in the paper, they're back on board with it.
Okay, I have no problem. I'm just asking what we're doing.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Yes.
So I'd like to take the letter with me, Mr. Welch.
We will make sure that you have one, sir.
Yeah, and I'll bring it to the board because that's Thursday night. So I'll stop in between now and Wednesday afternoon.
And we will get it for you.
Can I ask one more thing on the old?
Go ahead.
Did we put a bid out for the marsh pipes yet, or are we waiting for all this legislative process?
We're waiting for the legislative process. If it doesn't pass, it's us that's doing it.
Right, okay, that's what I figured, but I just wanted to ask. Yep. Okay.
I haven't been down to the beach. Any painted crosswalks yet? It's the end of May.
No. We've only sent a letter. Is the letter even gone out yet?
I don't even know it's gone out yet.
Should we have to send a letter?
But that's not up to us to do it. That's up to them to do that.
You're right.
And we don't ask, we don't tell them, we ask them.
I'll bring it up also at the Area Commission.
Anything else on old business? I have a couple of things. Mr. Town Manager, I saw your list of partial accomplishments during 2017 that we asked, and we're still waiting one from.
He wasn't in today, so I suspect you'll have it tomorrow probably.
All right, I know he's been busy, so I'd like to do that early June at some point if we can.
Right.
Let's see, I'd like to also, in early June, talk, maybe we can have the fire chief come in. He sent a report. Has everyone got this yet?
Yeah.
So we got the report on the minimum manning.
Yes.
On 9, and so we should have a chance to look at that fairly well by our next meeting.
Schedule it for your next meeting.
So, you know, what he's saying in here, what I take it is he's got almost $57,000 that it could be up to $57,000 to cover minimum manning to 9 through June, July, August, and September, first part of September.
Right.
If he can't find that money within his budget, what are the alternatives do we have?
Let him charge it and take it from the bottom line.
Yes.
Basically, you don't have many alternatives. With any other municipal budget, you charge the expenses that it relate to the individual department and their appropriate line item.
Mm-hmm.
If their bottom line of their department's budget goes over, then it comes out of the bottom line of the town budget.
Right.
Correct.
Same as the relationship welfare has the town budget.
Right. And knowing that, you know, we are on a default budget this year.
It's tight.
It's tight. But, you know, we've dealt with this for a long time. And I listen to that radio a lot. And I hear how many times they have to call for coverage. And
I do,
and,
too.
And how many times they're running.
Yeah.
And, you know, we had that fire in early April. And fortunately, he did have a full staffing. And
very fortunate.
We were fortunate we didn't burn down more of the beach than already burned. So I think this is a very important issue. I think we need to work with him to try to see how we can do this. And so I'd like to see that in early June.
So he's going to come in.
He's going to come in.
With a plan.
With a plan. Right.
Okay, good.
He's already sent it to us in writing.
Yep.
But I want to see it.
But I mean, a plan where the money can come from.
Well,
too.
Where the money can come from, or if he can't, we'll have to get it out.
But I mean, so we can have a lot of information prior.
Absolutely.
To.
I want as much information as we can have of where it's coming from.
Yeah.
And if he can't, tell us that it can't. But we need to do that. I was trying to think of anything else I had on the old business. Oh, I just had one. I had one a note from a person that. Was a Hampton resident and a frequent flyer at the transfer station.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, that was cute.
I think if people ought to hear this, he doesn't know who's running things over there. He says, whatever his name is, he's doing a phenomenal job sprucing the place up. Who knew it was possible to clean up and organize and streamline operations at the transfer station and do it with a friendly face and a positive attitude?
Yeah.
You know, part of the thing we did last week or two ago was to change that position there.
Yep.
And, this is just going on, and I think that's positive attitude when your employees are happy and they're working, they're doing stuff for the good of the town and good of the citizens.
Yeah.
So, anything else?
Rusty, really quickly on fire, I did ask the chief to produce enough of his reports, like the one he gave us, the one through April, to the budget committee, because I think the budget committee should be seeing this as we go through the year. And I'm going to be asking him to do that every report he makes, because this is critical to this community.
Oh, yeah.
And having the chief put in writing his report, I think is very important. So.
All right. One more thing. In old business.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention this because in case anyone has tuned in since the public comment, the one I mentioned it, that the Hampton Area Commission is this Thursday night at 7 o'clock in this meeting, because it wasn't on the TV. And that anyone that does want to come on, comment, they can always come and comment at 7 o'clock. And they're, I don't think it's too late to comment. And I think the board enjoyed seeing all of the enthusiasm and people paying attention. I know a lot of people have said to me, since that meeting, that, well, we never heard. We did try to get the word out. It wasn't as successful as what's happened since Nancy Stiles has been there. And, people just unfortunately didn't pay enough attention. And people keep asking me, I keep telling them that, the agenda is always posted for the Hampton Area Commission as well as the Board of Selectmen and any of the other planning board, zoning board. And a lot of people that are new to Hampton say, well, I never had to do that before. Well, Hampton's the type of town, people do that. And so, you know, you can always go online today and find that information. And if you're not the type of person that likes to go online, you can come in right where the doors are, and they're all posted right there. And it, you know, all you have to do is stop by once a week, and you can find out everything you need to know.
You're a brave man using the word enjoyed. I don't know how enjoyed.
All right, so now we have a new business. Yeah. First one is amendment to Chapter 542, Alarm Systems.
Yeah. Right. Mr. Chairman, we had a number of complaints because bills were sent out for people who were pulling false, not pulling, were having false alarms. Yeah. Most of the false alarms we get in the fire department are because people are having work done on their system and something goes wrong and the alarm goes off, and then that department's notified that it's a false alarm. I talked to the chief, and we have maybe 8 or 10 malicious alarms per year at the fire station. So we did some research, and what we found out was that the town does not have legislative authority from the general court to, in fact, have alarm system prohibited devices and so on and so forth. We can't find these people. We can't do anything with them for rendering a false alarm except to charge them with a misdemeanor or a felony. Now, one of these alarm systems, which is Chapter 542, is something the selectmen, in fact, put into effect way back in 1987. Wow. So it's a little old. What we're asking the board to do is to repeal Chapter 542 with regards to the fines and penalties for false alarms. We've talked to the departments, and they understand that these are criminal offenses, not civil offenses. And if they are, in fact, found to be criminal in nature, they had to report them to the police department. And the police department will investigate, and if they are criminal, they'll file the appropriate charges in the courts. But we don't have the authority either to assess these fees or to collect them, even if we file a case in court to collect them, because the legislation doesn't allow us to.
I'll make that motion.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
So might that come under malicious mischief in the police department?
Actually, there's a separate offense for false alarms, a separate statute. Okay.
So we can still cover...
We'll still cover the fact that it's either a felony or a misdemeanor.
Okay, great.
And there is another section that will be amended at the town meeting, which was enacted by town meeting under the fire department. Same thing.
Oh, good.
So we'll have everything in conformance with the general laws come spring.
Okay.
All right, number two on the new business is the Budget Committee Chair, Vice Chair, Direct Communications Access to the NHMA. Mm-hmm.
Mr. Chairman?
Board function.
I simply want to make a motion tonight as the Budget Committee Selectman Representative. I've been asked to make a motion to grant the Budget Committee Chairman and Vice Chairman communication access to New Hampshire Municipal Association.
I'll second.
Any discussion on it?
They feel like that they would like to be able to reach NHMA on their own.
And what's the policy now?
The policy is that I don't believe it.
You have to go through the
town
selectmen.
Manager.
Has to come to the board of selectmen.
Well, I would bring it to the board pretty much as the policy.
Any discussion?
What does Fred think about it?
You're damned if you do and damned if you don't. The system has worked fairly well with coming to the board for permission, usually through the Budget Committee representative from the Board of Selectmen, so that both parties know what's going on. It has prevented what happened in times past where a member of the Budget Committee called the Municipal Association and got one piece of advice that town council said was wrong on the final analysis and ended up with a fight between the two boards, which is the wrong thing to do.
It seems to me I remember the Municipal Association being very uncomfortable about this.
They were uncomfortable, yes.
Yes, that's how I remember.
Yeah, that's true, they are.
They didn't like it.
They wanted to stay with just representatives from the selectmen, but that's your function to determine whether or not they do or don't.
Well, personally, I think it should stay the way that it is. I mean, I don't mind if they, if you come and they have a problem and gets it come, you know, it's brought up and that distinct problem is maybe talked about or whatever.
Well,
but there was a reason why that was made that way.
Right, I realize. I'm just presenting it.
Yeah, oh, I understand.
It has to come here. I told them, and I, although didn't experience that in the past, I have heard stories about it. And I am also comfortable that if the Budget Committee had anything that they would like to ask NHMA, that I could get it to this board in an expedient manner.
I think
and
that's
we could
the way
get
it should
that
stay.
Off so that we so, could try to keep the comms on both sides.
Good.
Members of the Budget Committee pay their taxes like everybody else, and the dues for the NHMA are in the tax burden. So I think
I make a motion that it stay the same.
No,
we already have a motion to allow them to do it.
Oh.
So if you don't want it to happen, that would be a no. If you do it, yes.
You know, I just think that a chain of command is a good way of doing things. I think when boards start, every board starts doing their own communication, it does get confused and it does get. The town is a member of NHMA, right?
Correct.
Yes.
The whole town.
The whole town.
That's right.
But that would mean then any individual in town can go, it would be insane.
That's right.
Wouldn't work. I mean, I think a chain of command, and I think the chain of command has worked. I don't think there's been any refusals, have there?
I don't believe so.
When somebody has said, you know, I'd like to, I don't think there's been any refusals.
I don't think there is.
So I think it should stay the way it is.
Do you have any problem, Regina, being the go-between?
No,
and possibly even calling them at certain.
I don't even contact NHMA myself.
Yeah, I know.
We have a motion and a second.
And that's also part of, that is also part of the way it's supposed to be done. The Board of Selectmen's not supposed to be going there either. It's supposed to go through the board. We don't do it.
You have two bodies of independent elected officials. And I say that there should be no problem letting the chairman of the Budget Committee or the chairman of the Board of Selectmen dial up NHMA if they have a problem. It's not going to be constant contact.
Okay, so we have a motion. All those in favor? Those opposed? 4-1.
I have one other question about NHMA.
Yes.
Not related to the Budget Committee. Well, actually, it is related to the Budget Committee, but... so we pay them, what is it, approximately $17,000 a year?
Yes.
And
yes.
As part of that package, we usually get a free
training session.
Yep. Yep. Which probably, unless the town itself is planning on using it, we're probably not going to have one this year. So it was requested, since we're not having that training, if we could get copies of the 2017 budget book for every single member of the Budget Committee. Sent from NHMA at no cost.
We can ask, but I think what you're going to get for an answer is that there is a set fee set by the Board of Directors, and they would have to change it.
Yeah, okay.
And so if that's what you want, something in next year's budget, we should put it in next year's budget. If you feel that strongly, they should have that.
I'll ask the committee if they feel that strongly about it. Right.
And are they still doing the different classes and seminars that they have that they invite people?
Yes.
So any people should take advantage of that.
They also
I went. I like.
Yeah. They also have online.
Right.
Yes.
Webinars.
Yep. Webinars and stuff. Yep. So it's really good.
Any other stuff in new business?
Go. All right. I just wanted to say something that we got for a letter that came from DES that I know that the town probably already does this thing, does this already, but I want to highlight a couple things as far as we're talking about, you know, revisiting our fees and rates that we charge people.
Yep.
Well, this is a letter from the Department of Environmental Services to all places that have a wastewater treatment plant, owners, ethics, and responsibilities.
Yeah.
And 4, 5, and 11... four, the owner shall distribute funds into a capital reserve plan for future needs and replacement or upgrades, which we started doing with the soil maintenance fund, right? Would that fall under that?
Yeah.
And then number 5, the owner shall develop a rate and fee structure to cover all costs associated with the operation and maintenance of his system components. So I think that's going to be covered fairly well. We're working with Ripeas Town Management to assess the town and what we can do to maybe get some additional fee and can come in since we have all these expenses that are sort of hurling us all at one time. And number 11, If applicable, the owner shall develop an industrial pretreatment program for commercial, industrial, or institutional users connected to the system. So Mary Louise brought that up tonight, and I mean,
again,
this is not, I just want to make sure that when people, when we start doing this, this is not anything to single out businesses or companies or organizations that want to come and do business in Hampton. This is just the way, this is part of business. This is how we need to operate. Expenses always go up. Chairman Waddell said 4%, you know, for a budget increase 1 year, 5% another year. That's never going to go away. The only way you can offset it is with additional revenue.
Yeah.
And we have DES telling us to do what we've already do or are going to do, so that's good news.
Good.
And also one other thing about acquiring and PFCs. Attorney Gerald has stayed on this topic very closely, and he actually brought it to my attention that the deadline on the groundwater, gosh, they're going to kill me with this, drinking water SRF fund,
right.
State revolving fund. The initial deadline for that is going to be June 15th. And he would like the board to make a motion, which I'll just read this motion as he wrote.
Yep.
I move that the board urge Aquarian Water Company to apply for a grant under the Department of Environmental Services Drinking Water State Revolving Fund and the Drinking Water and Groundwater Trust Fund by the June 15th, 2018 pre-application deadline. For purposes of funding to maximum extent possible for those funds, the construction of a PFAS treatment facility for the Aquarian Wells in the Mill Road well field, and the conceptual design of which has already been presented to the board, which I think was roughly $6 million.
Right.
Yeah. Well, I sent an email out to two of the people that sit on the commission fund. It's the commissioner and the deputy commissioner of DES. And I also CC'd, as well as Aquarian and Eversource officials, requesting what Mark has already requested personally from me, because I have been talking with them on this. And I included DES officials, and I also included the state senator so that he could be aware of what we're trying to do. And I also included Councilor Prescott, because when Fred and I initially called him, I don't know, a few months ago, he was the one that actually suggested that the town get together with Aquarian and apply for this fund.
Good.
So I think it would be very important if the board made this motion to ask Aquarian to apply for these funds, since we're not the only ones that think that it's probably a good thing to do. You know, this came from the Governor's Council.
Seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Yeah, good.
Thank you.
Good work.
Anything else on a new business?
I make a motion that we adjourn at 8:55.
Motion adjourned, 8:55. There's a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Super.
Thank you.
Thank you.